to project a loud voice in order to get them to keep quiet, but I don't think I have to project that much here. Although I do, I've got the lake behind her, in front of me, and the song may not carry as well. But I appreciate the efforts coming to this, as we called it, the Baraga Rendezvous. And before we get into the formal part of the program, I'd like to introduce the president of the Twin Cities Slovenians, a member of Branch 109, the Slovenian Union of America, John Jockel.
Welcome, everybody. Appreciate you all coming to this very special event, honoring the memory of a very special man, Bishop Baraga. We've got a number of wonderful speakers lined up today, so I'm going to make this real quick. Just thank everyone who's come long distances, especially Congressman Overstar, flew in from Washington this week, I think, and Lenora McKean, I think, just drove in 7 hours from Marquette, Michigan, and I have a feeling some of the rest of you came long distances to be here as well. So thank you all for coming, and we're looking forward to a great program here. I see Yul is walking back there. Yul, I think, as you know, is been the man who's worked very hard the last 6 months to get this organized. So we're very fortunate to have a man like that. But without further ado, I'll turn it back to Norm to introduce our speakers.
Thank you, Jeff.
My name is Norm Setnicker. Originally born in Biawabic and former president of the Slovenian the Union of America's Branch 109, the Twin Cities Slovenians. And at this time, I would like to introduce Deacon Peter Mueller from the Grand Marais Parish. And Peter has some few choice words to address to our afternoon.
Thank you. Thank you very much. On behalf of our local ordinary, Bishop Paul Serma, and Father Seamus Waltz from Grand Marais, we welcome you all here to the North Shore. As you know, we serve both the parish of St. John's in Grand Marais and Holy Rosary in Grand Portage. And of course, today we're standing on, we're standing on historic ground. This is the site where Father Baraga, then Father Baraga, knelt in prayer, thanking God for safe passage to this spot during a heavy storm on Lake Superior. And he and his companion knelt, thanking God for that safe passage. And of course, they were missionaries, and they were here at the request of the chief in Grand Portage, of the Ojibwe tribe in Grand Portage, to minister to the people in the band. And this is a historic site, and even today, this site is used non-denominationally by many churches within the North Shore area that visit this site and kneel and pray and thank God and hold religious services on this site. So even today, the missionary nature of Bishop Baraga continues. You can travel along the North Shore, and you can see the influence that this priest had while he was on the North Shore. Yet today, if you go up to Grand Portage, you can see a list of people that he baptized, that Bishop Baraga baptized, while in the Grand Portage area. Not more than a month ago, our bishop was here rededicating this site to Bishop Baraga, because the local community joined together and refurbished the grounds. Large population from the local community was here at that time. Jim Norvell there directed this group, came, and they refurbished the site to honor Bishop Baraga. And you can stop down many times during the day, and you can see tourists along the area coming to this site to see what the good bishop did, what this site represents. So you all have a very strong heritage and a very strong connection to Bishop Baraga, and that's encouraging. That's encouraging and very heartwarming to see. And I've heard many stories already about your ancestors on the North Shore, particularly the Iron Range area, and the many priests and the many clergy of your heritage who served the population, and of course the hard work that was done in the mines on the North Shore. So even today, you can go to a museum, I actually thought it was still here, and see the plaque that Father Baraga used in commemoration or in thanksgiving of his safe passage. So the community today is very much in tune with Bishop Baraga and what he represents. So I thank you all for coming. I thank you for the opportunity to be here with you and to learn about you and your relatives and ancestors that served us so great on the North Shore. And before I leave, I just would ask God's blessing on all of us. So may the blessing of Almighty God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit descend upon you and remain with you forever. Amen.
Amen.
Thank you.
Thank you. Note that on September 21st, 1823, is when Bishop Baraga was ordinated as a priest into the Catholic faith. And so 2012, September, will be the 189th anniversary of Bishop Baraga's ordination. So again, I think we of the Slovenian heritage feel awfully blessed that he has done so much for Minnesota, for the country, and for all of us. So at this time, I would like to introduce our next speaker, who traveled from Marquette, Michigan. She is the Associate Director of the Baraga Association, Lenora McQueen. Lenora?
Thank you very much. It's quite an honor to be here. So first of all, I thank you for inviting me. As Norm said, I'm the newest Associate Director of the Baraga Association. I've been here since June, so I'm learning lots very, very quickly. I want to spend just a few minutes telling you about the association, what our mission is, and what our goals are. The mission of the Bishop Baraga Association is to make him known to all people, to use his example of Catholic faith to instill the love of God in others, and to preserve materials pertaining to his life with our ultimate goal to glorify God by honoring honoring his name with the title of saint. That's the journey that we're on. It's been a very long journey, but it's starting to move quickly. We're going to come back and talk about that in just a minute. The Baraga Association was founded in 1930, and one of the principal founders was Joseph Gregory. Joseph also wrote Apostles of the Chippewa, that you may have read. It's an 88-page primer that really lays out the basics of Father Frederic Baraga, his life and his approach. The association is completely funded by the members. So for those of you that are members, we thank you. You are what makes it possible to do the work that we're doing. We have five goals at the association. And the first one is to promote the cause, to educate, to continue to show the support and love of Baraga to the Holy See. The second goal is to educate people on his life. I notice some of you have our Baraga Bulletin. That is something that members receive quarterly, and it is a great way to educate people on the different information of Baraga, his different walks of life, and how he touched people worldwide. It's incredible the impact that one man had on this area, but on his home country as well. One of the other goals is to plan annual celebrations, and we have our Bishop Baraga Days, which is an annual event coming up next weekend. So if you haven't registered, there's still time. I still have tickets left. The fourth goal is to preserve materials pertinent to Baraga. And at the association, we have several artifacts that have been collected from St. Peter's Cathedral in Marquette, from Bishop Baraga's home in Marquette, as well as along his journey throughout the lower Michigan, upper peninsula Michigan, Minnesota, and Wisconsin. And our final goal, which I think is probably the most critical that wraps everything up, is to prepare for the sainthood of Bishop Baraga. It's taken a while, but we will get there. We will get there. Right now we have a membership drive underway. There are two kinds of memberships. There's an annual membership, which is $10. There's a lifetime membership, which is $50. It entitles you to a quarterly bulletin, and then we also try to keep you in the know of what's going on, the different events that are going on in different communities, information about Baraga Days. It's so important for that membership to be strong, because as the Holy See is evaluating everything that we put forth to move him towards sainthood, they look at the amount of support he has. And one of the easiest ways for them to measure that support is in numbers. So it's so important. I hear people all the time say, I wish there was more I can do. There is. By being a member, by talking to people, recruiting people into the association, that just shows the Holy See how much love and devotion we have to God's faithful servant, Bishop Baraga. I've just developed a youth membership. For a nominal fee of $5, a youth can join the association, and that will carry them till their 18th birthday. I think it's important that we teach our youth about Baraga. The other hat that I wear when I'm not working as the associate director, I'm also the director of religious education at St. Anthony's Church in Gwynn. And I work closely with the diocese on our curriculum. And there's a glaring absence. We have a saint among us. I have children. They may never be able to say that again. And we are not educating them on Bishop Baraga. So that's something we need to correct. We need to make sure our young people know about Bishop Baraga, that they know the life he led. And they start to learn to incorporate the choices that he made into their own life. Rates are going to increase in October, so if you don't have a membership, there are cards. Feel free to get it sent in. I've pushed it off as long as I can, begging Father Ben to allow me to wait until after Baraga Day. So I know that an increase is coming. I don't know how much, but at least you've gotten fair notice. Baraga Days. Baraga Days is coming up next weekend in Marquette. I am so excited. Baraga Days is a two-day event. If you've never been, this is an international event. We will have people coming from Slovenia. Bishop Glavan will be there saying the Slovenian Mass. We have people from Canada, Chicago, Ohio, buses coming from everywhere. I'm told to expect 600 to 700 people next weekend. So I'm very excited to be a part of it. Once it alternates every year. One year it's in the Diocese of Marquette, the next year it's outside the diocese. So last year it was in Gaylord, this year it's in Marquette. Next year, October 5th and 6th, please mark your calendars, because we're coming to Duluth. We just made the decisions. I met with them yesterday. We're looking at securing the venue, which we have. And so I'm very pleased to announce that we will be here next year. And I think there's a whole group of people that we can help educate about Bishop Baraga. We have so many things this year lined up with Baraga Days that are a little different than in the past. I want people to get a feel for what it was like to be Bishop Baraga. You'll have access to the crypt, which I know is accessible at all times, which we're working on making it even more accessible. For the first time ever, we're going to open up the Baraga House. So you'll be able to go into the death room where Baraga spent his final hours. And you'll be able to pray what it was like when Baraga was there, and it will take one foot in the door for you to feel the Holy Spirit. It's an unbelievable room. And then we are going to open up the Baraga Association for an open house for a couple of hours each day, because I want people to come and be able to see the relics and the artifacts that we have. We have beautiful things, his bishop's ring, his pectoral cross, part of his stole, one of the socks that was used in a couple of the miracles. So I want people to be able to see those. So those are going to be open next weekend for Baraga Days. In addition to that, we have a 6 o'clock Slovenian Mass on Saturday and a banquet following, and we have the Singing Slovenes, which is Frank Bukar from Duluth, that will be playing. Then on Sunday, there's a 2 o'clock English Mass, and again a banquet with the Singing Slovenes. But there's an addition to the Sunday banquet. Not only will we have our brief Bishop Baraga Association meeting, Bishop Sample is going to unveil his plans for the new chapel project. You guys got a sneak peek in the bulletins that you have in your hands. Those have not mailed out. They're supposed to be en route as I'm en route up here. So people have not seen those plans. But with the recent declaration of Bishop Baraga being declared venerable, which occurred May 10th, that means he can be publicly venerated, publicly prayed to, and he needs to be publicly accessible. The crypt is accessible. You can go there as long as St. Peter's is open, but it's in the basement. It is handicap accessible, but again, it's in the basement. We want him moved. We want him to be on the main floor of the cathedral. So Bishop Sample will be unveiling his plans, but it's looking like we will be doing an addition on the courtyard side of St. Peter's Cathedral. So for those of you that have been there, it'll be close to the sacristy where the oils are housed right now. And Bishop wants two entrances. He wants one from the cathedral proper, and as you go into the chapel, you will see a stained glass of Bishop Baraga. He wants a second entry from the courtyard because he wants it to be accessible regardless of the activities that are going on at the cathedral. So I'm so excited that this is one small step on our journey. We're going to make a little pit stop for the venerable, and then we're going to move to blessed and saint very quickly, I hope. I've had people ask me, what's it going to take to keep this process moving? And it has been a long haul. They started this in 1952, is where they determined that there was enough evidence to begin. So 2012, we get the notification that he's venerable. It's a two-track process. And in this second track, we need two miracles to be attributed to Bishop Baraga. On July 17th of 2011, documents were signed and sealed and sent to the Holy See that are currently under review by the Congregation for the Causes of Saints in Rome. And the one miracle that they're looking at now was actually a young woman who, they discovered a tumor on her liver. She resides up in the Sioux, so this is a current miracle. She had an ultrasound done, and they saw the tumor. It was very good size, and felt like they needed to do exploratory surgery to see the effects of the tumor. So she went to her parish priest and her family prayed, and her parish priest asked for the intercession of Bishop Baraga, and they laid Baraga's stole on her abdomen. As soon as they did that, she said that the pain went away. And I know sometimes that's easy for people to say, oh, well, you know, she just said that. So they go in, the doctors go in to do the exploratory surgery that was scheduled. There's no evidence of a tumor. It's gone. The thing that we need for this to be considered a miracle is the absence of medical treatment, and there was no medical treatment. That was what they were doing with the exploratory surgery. So we are very, very prayerful that they will see this and see how clearly it defines a miracle, and they will make that move to blessed. Once Bishop is determined to be blessed, then we need another miracle to come forth that they will review and call him a saint. So we are well on our way. I've had people say, I wish there were more that I could do. There are two things that we need to ask for. We need your continued prayer and support. The prayers have an unbelievable impact. We see it every day in our lives. And the membership is so critical. We need to prove to the Holy See how many devoted Bishop Baraga people there are that are behind God's faithful servant and the work that he's done in this entire area. He's credited for bringing 19 Slovenian missionaries to this area, Upper Peninsula, Michigan, Minnesota, Wisconsin, and Lower Michigan. That doesn't even count the number of people that came over because of them. So I can't imagine where we would be today without him. But I know that I hold him near and dear in my heart every day. He never let an obstacle stand in his way. He had to go 57 miles to baptize a child who was sick that they thought was going to die. He could not fathom the idea of somebody dying without being baptized. He never thought, 57 miles, are you kidding me? That's really out of my way. Off he went. He would do whatever it took. God has his plan, and he works in his own way, in his own time. When I took this job, I was here about 5 minutes and went on a mission trip to Honduras. In my bag, I took one book, Apostles of the Chippewa, because I needed to get to know Baraga a little bit. He was with me on that entire mission. It was hot some days, but it stuck in the back of my head. I bet it was hot some days for Baraga. He never complained about it, and he never let it stop him. It was cold lots of days for him. He never let that stop him. There were times that they tracked him on his snowshoes because his feet were bleeding so bad because he had given his shoes away to somebody that needed them more, and he was snowshoeing barefoot. There was never a challenge that was beyond him. He never let that stop him. And he was a father and a bishop for everyone. He was about the people. The only thing I would ask is you take a little bit of Baraga and you put it in your heart and you let it help you make your decisions and guide you every day. Thank you guys very much.
Really personalized Father Baraga, and I didn't realize how extensive Father Baraga's influence was. And I have to claim ignorance on a lot of the points, but he really helped clarify a lot. At this time, I'd like to introduce Vice President of Culture and Heritage for the Slovenian Union of America, who's been an advocate, a researcher of Father Baraga, and has really kept the Slovenian tradition alive. Mary Lou Volk. Mary Lou.
Louder. I have to speak level. I am second generation, 100% Slovenian. My first words were mama and daddy and petita and strukla and what else? Strudel and Baraga. He was born in Slovenia, arrived in America in 1830. For 37 years, he moved among 80,000 square miles, sensitive to the needs of everyone. Now, if that isn't a miracle, I don't understand that. But he was sensitive to all in need. I'd like to do a few quotes from Baraga. Demands nothing else from you but your goodwill. He went to them wherever they were. No North Face parka, no Kenetrek snowpacks, no sleeping bag, no polar fleece hat. I quote from Baraga, 15 miles from any house in the deep snow, an intensely cold night, no fire, completely exhausted. There was no choice but to walk on or to freeze. No lights in the town, no motel with a bed, no GPS to guide him. Baraga quote, I am also rich as rich as I have ever been in my life, for I have a satisfied and happy heart. Baraga left us a message that I feel is for all generations, and it is for us to internalize. A Baraga quote, "Look not mournfully into the past, it cannot return. Wisely improve the present, it is thine. Go forth to meet the shadowy future without fear and with a manly heart."
At this time, I would like to introduce, former Iron Ranger, former U.S. Congressman from Chisholm, Mr. Jim Oberstar.
My, what beautiful thoughts, what wonderful images and heart-touching expressions, those quotes from Baraga. There are others that we could also cite, especially his last testament, that his final wish was that in the great beyond that he will be there, surrounded by those children that he baptized to welcome them into the eternity with our Lord. The snowshoe priest, it's so fitting to have the snowshoes here, who was reported to have covered 700 miles in a month. And as we just heard, without a North Face parka, without fleece, without boots, without and with bleeding feet. He was born in Slovenia at the time when our forefathers created our government. The new government of the United States was just getting underway when Frederic Baraga was born. And it was a government whose principles of popular democracy, of consent of the governed and vote of the people, were inspired by the Dukes of Carinthia, whose works had been read by Thomas Jefferson and inspired him in writing the Declaration of Independence and in contributing to the articles that became the Constitution of the United States and the separation of powers and a government founded on consent of the governed, a Slovene initiative. In the day when in the 13th, 14th, 15th century to succeed as Duke of Carinthia, the pretender to the throne had to come and present himself to the župan, the Musabi range. We had Monsignor Schiffer in my parish in Chisholm, Father Skumak, the polka priest, Father Frank Perkovic, and Father Pierce, for whom a town is named in central Minnesota, Pierce, Minnesota. And those were the days of, as Braga invoked us all, of obedience. You marched into church and you did everything, you're very obedient, very. But what resonates and what I think of is Čečena si Maria, the Slovenian women's choir that would sing at funerals. But it could also be sung in happier moments as well. But mostly, and what we're losing today is that culture of the past, and we need this Slovene community to continually reawaken and regenerate the current generation descendants of early Slovenes and the sounds of the button box as we walked in. Thank you so much for that beautiful, resonant music. When I went back to, when I went to Slovenia for the fifth anniversary of Slovenia's independence, and we traveled to Ribnica, where the Oberstar family originated. My grandmother, Maria Strle, was from Sodražica, but there are no Strle left. They all migrated someplace else. So we went to Ribnica, and over 100 Oberstars came out. We had Putica and Šunka and Pohanja and the button box and the Slovenian men's chorus, and we stood and sang, and the TV came and covered the whole event. And then we left the cultural center and went down the street to the cathedral where Father Oberstar said Mass. it's all alive and well, and they're proud. The Slovenes of today are proud of their heritage, proud of their independence. What I found, and I had spent a great deal of time supporting the initial plebiscite of independence in December of 1990, and encouraged young people in particular. I did many interviews for Delo, the Slovene newspaper in Ljubljana, and I said, if the young people lead, you will have independence, you will vote it. And they did. They voted 94% for independence, with 96% of the people turning out to vote. You know, we don't have that kind of voter participation in this country, and we need to learn from Slovenia how to do it. It's important. And what I found were youthful leaders, excited about the future, excited about charting their course and becoming part of the European Economic Community. And I participated with them and worked with the French and the Belgians and the Germans and others to secure Slovenia's acceptance into the European Economic Community. And within a year, they had driven their inflation rate from 1,200% down to 5%. They had privatized all the industries that had been nationalized during the socialist communist era. They had a $3 billion positive international balance of payment. They did it with caution, with pragmatism, with resilience, and industries like Rogaška Glassworks that now are selling under their own name. They're not selling it under Mikasa of Japan or Waterford Crystal Work. They're selling it as Rogaška Works. They're proud. They're standing on their two. They know who they are. They know what they can represent in the international community. The finest aviation maintenance facility in Europe is in Slovenia, where they maintain aircraft for Lufthansa at the Ljubljana Airport. They built a brand new facility. And now, not only are they maintaining aircraft, they are training maintenance personnel for other airlines and other maintenance facilities around Europe in Ljubljana. Slovenes leading the way. The wines of Slovenia, the sunny side of the Alps, rival those of France. The only problem is they don't produce enough. They drink more of it for themselves than they ship overseas. In 2004, Slovenia, again my participation and that of several others that I enlisted, including our Secretary of Defense, admitted to NATO. And as Ambassador Roman Kiran said in his talk in September last year at the University of Minnesota, Slovenia moved from being a consumer of security to being a provider of security. And of all of the wonderful initiatives of Slovenia, the International Trust for Demining, Slovenes, seeing children blown up by the mines that have been spread throughout Slovenia, through Croatia, Bosnia, Herzegovina, said we need to do something about it. We, Slovenes, need to do something about it. And they initiated this international trust for demining. I heard about it. I saw what they were doing. So I went to our Appropriations Committee in the House, and with bipartisan support, we have provided $160 million, over $13 million a year, a period of many years, for the demining. Result, 11 million landmines have been removed.
Oh, wow.
Kosovo, Macedonia, Albania, Montenegro are mine-free. Meaning children can walk through fields and not be blown, farmers can plow their lands and not be blown up, not lose a leg or an arm or an eye. Bosnia and Croatia will soon be mine free because of the Slovene International Trust for Demining. And they have rehabilitated over 1,000 people with prosthetics to replace the arm or the leg or the foot that was blown off by those terrible landmines. And if you travel to Slovenia, make sure you go to see the museum where they have captured and displayed the terrible weapons of destruction that humankind has created to destroy one another and show how awful these things are. From the harbor on Slovenia, there's very little eye on the Adriatic. They have a World War I floating mine that was captured, still operating, still capable of blowing up. Germans are very good at those things. They know how to build destructive things. But the Slovenes have decommissioned it, made it safe. So and in fact, it was Slovenes who invented a safe way of finding the landmines. They had people first, then they had dogs, and then they experimented with bees, feeding bees minuscule microscopic amounts of the chemicals that make up the major explosives. And then they set the bees free, and they would go right over in a bee line and hover over the landmine. Now you can decommission it without risk of loss of life or injury. So the International Trust, a characteristic French, a characteristically Slovene initiative. It was Slovenia's poet laureate, the one who crystallized the Slovene language, France Prešeren, who in 1848, in the what was known then as the Prague Spring, wrote this poem that is so fitting for us today. God's blessing on all nations who long and work for that bright day when o'er earth's habitations no war, no strife shall hold its sway. Who long to see that all men free shall no more foes but neighbors be. Slovenes who put that into practice, the International Trust for Demining, and the European Economic Community, who with only 3 years into the admission to the EU became the first of the newly admitted, 27 newly admitted countries to be the presidency of the European Union, who have led the way in peaceful demonstration and practicing a successful democracy with the highest respect for human rights in the world. We are all proud, honored to be here and to be inspired by Father Baraga.
So I will let them sing, and please join in if you know the words.
Yeah.
Of the day is going to talk about Bishop Baraga's relationship with the natives. We're very honored to have Father Michael Tegeder from the Twin Cities, I believe. Mm-hmm. Michael. And I'll let Michael go ahead with
Thank you.
Wonderful to be here with all these Slovenians. I have great admiration for Slovenia, and I'll explain that in a little bit, but to be here on this magnificent day, to be here where the bishop came out of his compassion for people, what a privilege it is to be here today. I knew about Bishop Baraga as a young boy. Over 50 years ago, when my parents would drive up the North Shore, we would always stop here. They wanted me to know about this holy man. Now, my background is not Slovenian. I'm not Slovenian. I'm not Ojibwe. I'm more Dutch than anything. But they knew how holy this man was. And I've come to learn about him, especially in terms of his relationship with the Indian people. I am now at a parish in Minneapolis that serves the Indian population, the Catholic Church of Gichita Katiri. And we're talking about the canonization of Bishop Baraga. Well, we're going to have the bishop, the canonization of what is now Blessed Katiri, but will soon be on October 21st, St. Katiri. After you have to wait, you know, she died in 1687, so And I have to say the one thing, there's a book by Ken Woodward on making saints. And he gives the best way to become a saint is to be a priest who starts a congregation of women religious. Because those women, once you die, those women religious will go to the wall for you. They'll pray you up. They'll knock on those walls in the Vatican. They have the highest percentage. Unfortunately, Bishop Baraga was so busy he never got around to starting a women's religious group. But I'm planning to do that myself. So if there are any volunteers. But we have a beautiful Indian parish. And it's even more beautiful because we actually sing the hymns that Bishop Baraga composed with the Indian elders. And I have Larry and Claire Martin with me today. They're from our parish. They both teach at the University of Wisconsin in Eau Claire. And Larry, his great-great-great-grandmother was the Madeline of Madeline Island. And so that connection with Baraga is very strong. We still sing his hymn. Tomorrow at 10:30 in the morning, we'll be singing these hymns of Bishop Baraga with the Indian community. And they're not all Ojibwe. We have Dakota and other tribal people, but among other things, we sing some of these hymns that were composed with Bishop Baraga and the Ojibwe elders so long ago. He had a tremendous personal effect on people, but especially on the Indian people. He went to the bat for the Indian people. Congressman Obistar, if he was a congressman back then, Bishop Baraga went to Congress for the rights of the Indian people and how they were being exploited. He did not allow that to happen. Thankfully, he saved a lot of the people living in northern Wisconsin. He really was their voice and helped to keep them to keep intact. He saw the beauty of their culture. He saw the spirituality of their culture. He just wanted to share Christ with them. But he didn't want to make them into other than Indians. So he is a good friend of the Indian people, the Ojibwe people in particular, and their defender. He had a big impact on priests. Came over here out of hearing about Bishop Baraga to serve the Indian people. Now, when he got here, there were so many other needs, and he ended up serving in central Minnesota. But he came originally to serve the Indian people. There's another Slovenian priest who I followed after some time, Frederic Jaeger. Father Jaeger was from Ljubljana. He heard, as a young student, he heard about Bishop Baraga and the Indians, and that's what he wanted to do. He came to the United States as a young seminarian. He was ordained in about 1890 by Bishop John Ireland. He was ordained hoping to be a missionary to the Indians, like his beloved Baraga. But they had other needs for him, and he ended up serving the Germans down there outside of Minneapolis and St. Bonifacius for about 50 years. Wonderful man. He started schools. Slovenians love education. You can have all kinds of earthly attainments, but if you're not educated, forget it. So education. He started a night school for the young men because their education ended in eighth grade. He taught them mathematics so they could get jobs in construction and other things. He was a wonderful man. You mentioned about the bees. He had a farm. That's how he supported the parish, his own farm. And he started beekeeping. He taught beekeeping science. He's a professor of beekeeping science at the University of Minnesota. She's American professor now of beekeeping science, Martha Spivak. They still talk about him as being such a great influence because of his scientific understanding of bees, and that probably had this effect on the mind. I never heard this before. That's fantastic. But he came out of love for the Indian people too, out of respect for what Bishop Baraga did. So, and it wasn't just a one-way street with the bishop. You know, he had an effect on them, but they had an effect on him. Take a look at the pictures of Bishop Baraga. Does he not look like an Indian elder in his last years? His heart was transformed in that degree to out of his love for these people. I've met so many missionaries. I know missionaries that have gone to South America, to Latin America, to Africa. They don't want to come back. They only want to come back to visit. They are so identified with those people that they serve. And this is true for Bishop Baraga. He was so identified with the Indian people. He loved them as brothers and sisters. And we still sing his songs. And what a privilege that is. So I'm just thinking, we're going to sing two songs. One isn't from Bishop Baraga. It's actually much older, but it's called the Huron Carol. And it's a Christmas carol. But what is Christmas about? It's about Christ coming into the world. Well, every day Christ comes into the world. That's why Bishop Baraga came across this lake, to bring Christ. And so we're going to sing this hymn. And it's a beautiful hymn because it was written by a French Jesuit for the Huron people. But he enculturates it into their understanding. It's a Christmas story as an Indian 400 years ago would have known it, would have understood it. And so it's a beautiful song. We're going to sing that. And then we're going to sing one of the songs that Bishop Baraga wrote along with the Indian elders. He wrote them with in a conjunction with the Indian elders. And we, like I say, this is a special blessing for us to sing this. But this enculturation is so important. Just a few weeks ago, I was at the Tekakwitha conference with Larry, and we heard a priest, Father Jim Nesbitt. He's a Cree Indian background. And he was talking about how the Jesuits, when they went to China, they had what they called the Chinese rites. And many Chinese were very interested in this Christ and becoming, and he incorporated some of the Chinese traditions into the Catholic rituals. That was prohibited out of ignorance, I think, and out of some fear. But Father Jim said something that was just amazing. He said if those rites could have been allowed to go on, China today would be as Catholic as the Philippines. Think about that. What a different world we'd be living in. Mm. Bishop Baraga came and he appreciated the wonderful traditions of the Indians. But if we could have accepted some of that, would we have all the pollution that Congressman Overstar had to fight against with the Clean Waters and the Clean Air Acts and all the rest? We don't have those values. But those are values of the Slovenian people. Those are traditional values of the Indian people. We have to get back to those and appreciate what we can learn from one another. So I'm going to ask Larry to play the Indian flute and Claire to help sing these along with us. We can join in. I'm just going to offer some tobacco. When we ask God something, we always make a sign of our willing to give something. And
this singer doesn't need to be introduced to you because you know it.
I'm not 100% Slovene. Not at all. I'm not 100% Ojibwe either, but I'm partly. My father was Ojibwe, my mother was Scandinavian. I look more like she did, I guess. I'm an enrolled tribal member at Lakota Ray in northern Wisconsin. I'm going to say in Ojibwe one of Father Baraga's prayers that's in the Chippewa prayer book. Chippewa, Ojibwe are the same word, just heard differently by the French and English. We prefer to call ourselves Anishinaabeg, which is the same thing again. Most of you noticed that eagle that came right over here.
Yeah.
I don't know if you know what a big thing that is. When you're having a ceremonial thing. Gathering of any sort, if an eagle visits like that, wow. I mean, that is big, big medicine. So I'm going to change things a little bit. I'm going to say the Baraga prayer in Ojibwe, and then I'm going to do an eagle greeting song, I think. The question is if I can, you know, get that wonderful Slovenian hymn you just sang out of my ear and do the Ojibwe thing. But it's quite simple. It keeps repeating. The Ojibwe word for eagle is Magizi. Plural is Magiziwag. You'll hear that word. And then there are just some syllables that connect the words. So maybe if you can kind of join in, I'll go through it a couple of times after the prayer. Manadu, Ishi Manadu, Shivani Mishano, maybe Kuchi Wandan, you, Kirchgan, you, Nagiziwag, Nagamoin and the indigenous Kaz, Nagizin and Odem, Ishi Manadu, Beijing one, Begosenum, Igoyan, Gakina magizi wag, gakina manadu, way, 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 ha, way, way, ha, way, way, ha, way, 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 ha. Gakina wiggy man, gakina manadu, way, 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 ha, way, way, ha, way, way, ha, way. Kina Benesi Yag, Bakina Manesi Wag, Ye Way, Ye Ha, Way, Way, Ha, Way, Way, Ha, Way, 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 Ha, Kakina Megizi Wag, Kina Benesi Yag, Way, 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 Ha, Way, Way, Ha, Way, Way, Ha, Way. You know, Father Mike was talking about how Father Baraga sort of became Indian and worked with the Indians, and he got a lot of help from Indians, you know. I mean, on these songs, as Mike said, and his Ojibwe language work, the Indian people helped him with a lot of that. And I don't think anybody mentioned, but, you know, there was an Indian with him in that canoe coming across here. Uh-huh. Yeah. Yeah. I need to remember that. Okay, the first song is the one in English, the Huron Carol. It was written by Jean de Brebeuf.
We're singing the different words.
Oh, yeah, that's right. In the first verse, yeah, I don't know that this, whoever did this.
This is from the Lutheran hymnal.
Yeah, right. But it's in the Catholic hymnal. This is not a translation of the original Huron Carol exactly. It's inspired by it. And it's very odd. In the first verse, the second line says, Mighty, it says, Gitchi Manitou sent an angel, sent angel choirs instead. The word is Gijimanadu, which is Ojibwe. And I think what they're doing here, Huron is a totally different language, completely different, unrelated. Is he back?
Not the eagle, but once I guess is enough.
Yeah. At Harry, at our church, we pronounce it Gijimanadu, Gijimanadu. So when you get there, you try to remember that, Gijimanadu. I'm going to play, this is not very loud, but at least be able to give the pitch to the vocalists over here, and then the rest of you can catch from them. I need to hold this up. Yeah. That's it. I'll just play it.
Was in the cool of winter time when all the birds had fled, that mighty Egyptian angel sang angel choirs instead.
Chippewa prayer book. Many editions, I think 8 editions. I looked at them and kept adding more hymns to each edition. And this is one that we use at the church. They're not translations of French or English hymns, but he used French melodies and created new Ojibwe poems with his Indian helpers. For the most part, a couple of them are translations, but mostly they're really fresh Indian poems. The prayer books don't have any music. They just give the words, and it'll say like it is here, "Sur l'air grand Dieu, quel favour." Sing it to that song. And in Baraga's time on Madeline Island, fur trade was still strong enough, going strong, that the two languages people used around here were Ojibwe and French. And the people knew the French songs from the voyageur, the canoe people who used to sing as they paddled, I think. And also some hymn tunes, French hymn tunes. So Baraga used those hymn tunes. Baraga used the hymn tunes, but he created these new poems with his Indian helpers. And this is a nice one. By the last edition, he had over 100 of these Ojibwe hymns. And I kind of prepared an edition of them. It's not published yet. Maybe someday the folks in Marquette will publish them. But a little advertising here. Anyway, I translated them, and I kind of analyzed them grammatically and some other things. And I also converted them to the kind of spelling system we use for Ojibwe today, which is, Father Baraga was a genius in the spelling system he created at the time. He really created a writing system for Ojibwe, which did not have a written tradition. And it's a very good one, but it's been improved upon. And the one we use now, it really, you can pronounce it just like it looks, and you're going to be pretty well. The words doesn't ask you to make, Ojibwe does not ask you to say any kind of strange sounds or anything. The words are very long, but if you just look at one syllable at a time, you'll be fine. Claire and this wonderful tenor are going to lead us. Claire helped with the edition that I did too. She's a much better musician than I am, and she helped me run down some of these French songs, since Father Baraga does not give the notes. We had to do a good deal of library research on old French hymnals and so on, and Claire was pretty much in charge of that. And she also, you know, prepared them, the manuscript, these things, what do they call them, sheets. Yeah, long sheets. And Jawa Nagus means I am blessed. I am blessed. Geget onzam is two ways of intensifying. So I am really, really blessed. In Jawa Nagus, geget onzam. And then the translation is at the bottom. You can kind of glance at that. It's a list of all the things the Creator has blessed us with. You know, that's what it is. And we're thanking the Creator for all of those things. Beautiful, beautiful, beautiful hymn.
And if you're in Minneapolis on a Sunday morning at 10:30, 3045 Park Avenue, you're welcome.
Yeah, try to join in, but if you sing so well, I think you're going to be just fine. But at least join in on the refrain, which keeps coming. Gegat nin gichija winimig gakina gegu win miminig gusinan gijigong gichi na ne ta winjige. That last word is wonderful. Jawenjige means to be merciful, to be kind, and you put a ne in front of it, that means you're good at whatever it's saying, and so we're saying to God, and a pidgey is another intensifying thing, God, you're really good at being merciful, huh? You're really good at being merciful. I don't know how I translated that, would I say? Yes, always. He's always merciful, but it really means more, not so much always, but you see, God's really good at that, you know? And we're all grateful for that. Okay, I'll play just a little bit of it, I'll just
play it.
Thank you.
This ceremony at the end, it's fun to get impromptu things happening. The eagle above, the
maybe not impromptu.
Well, maybe not. But again, thank you very much, Father, and thank you for all coming. I know there was a lot of planning. Yul has done a lot. I hope we met your standards, Yul. For all the planning that you put into it, and I think all of us are going to leave with a better appreciation and more appreciation for Father Baraga's efforts and his connection with the Slovenian culture and community. And I know I learned, and I'm going to leave with a lot more knowledge than I came here with.
Norm, if I might just intercede. One person who was not very important, was not acknowledged, is Miro Medved, who is the honorary consul of Slovenia for Minnesota, the only one from Chicago to, I think, Denver, and was designated by the foreign minister, Samuel Zvogar, who was former ambassador of Slovenia to the United States. So Miro is the first consul representing Slovenia in Minnesota. And thank you for being here, Miro.
About that, and it's quite an honor for us as well. And I know that Miro has done a lot for our and Roger.
If you're up on the UP, it's Baraga. If you're Minnesota, it's Baraga. But anyway, as long as my Slovenian blood is just pumped up with all kinds of pride, this event and hearing all the good things about the bishop, we have to change that sign.
Wow. Thank you very much. We noticed that. And I think the word has come out that it has to be changed. And I appreciate your being here.
What's up about the Indian on there, too?
Me, Slovens, Vincent, Nepradamo. We drink it, we don't sell it.
Thanks for that.
That's good, yes.
Thank you very much for coming.
Thank you. Thank you for the wonderful music.